5 panelists, 5 topical issues, no holds barred.
For me, it's not knowledge that's lacking. It's that greed, it's that mentality where you feel you deserve to take your own and take it infinitely and let everybody else just manage however they want.
We're almost becoming hardwired to try and cheat. I would, you know, suggest that we begin to hold our leaders accountable.
There was a time in this country when yes. things actually work.
I don't think that any organization should be above the law. And I think one of the challenges we have in this country is about governance across the board.
Well, what I'm saying is that it doesn't really affect us in Nigeria.
I don't know what we can do if the system is already corrupted.
We've been warned as a continent of the influx of the Chinese. If you don't repay your debt, they will just colonize you.
Oh, hi, Emeka. Hello, advocates. Certainly, distance is no obstruction if you're a creature of survival like us. You merely adapt. A change for survival. Life will be entirely different after the COVID-19 pandemic abates. This has been an ongoing experience like no other. Not even Ebola was this fearful. Its statistics show that deaths are still a small percentage of the afflicted, but the majority of cases so far have been in developed countries. And they, more so than others, are better equipped to handle the pandemic. In Nigeria, they show us beds, but without ventilators, what's the use? We do not even have the staff, the doctors, the nurses, to deal with a pandemic should it manifest here. Already, very poor Nigerians have started to worry about survival in the period of lockdown. They have come out to hawk stuff to try to make money. They have also come out to protest. Ironically, this is when our legislators have taken delivery of brand new cars for themselves. Yet, we have not built new meaningful health centers in decades. Schools and universities are now trash, and with the shutdown of educational facilities, children will bear the brunt of the dislocation that will be the resultant effect of all this. They will be stunned by the neglect, greed, and carelessness that their forebears have exhibited. Businesses will collapse, never to regain position. The oil industry has been decimated. Many will lose their lives. We must now prepare for a brave new world, one in which we must make sense of our development goals, one where we must get rid of the present crop of selfish people who present themselves for governance. And we must make this a deliberate change to survive.
Thank you for your advocacy. We just want to, I want to just tease it out a bit, you know, and try and understand the thrust of it. Essentially, what you're saying to me is survival of the fittest may well emerge as a result of people not doing what they ought to have done on time. So you may now find people, because they want to survive at all costs, having to take the bull by the horns at the grassroots. Am I getting you right there?
A little bit of that. Basically, it's more to do with changing how we vote, how we elect people, how we do things, so that we begin to make progress. It's clear that we've made no progress for 60 years, and now we're cut out. If you notice, recently everything the presidential task force has been doing is basically thanking all sorts of people for contributing. So I wonder, doesn't the government have its own money? You know what I mean? It's the task force just keeps telling us about thank you to the UN, thank you to WHO, thank you to everybody that's been giving money or ventilators from China and this and that. Nothing has been mentioned about what Nigeria is actually spending on its own to get things right. Apart from, of course, the money they say they give to the people who are very poor. They seem to just be thanking everybody else. That means that we were not in a position to do anything.
Just to think about it. I mean, it's yes. good that the point you make is very valid. It's a consequence. What we're seeing as consequences of the actions or inactions or actions that we failed to take over the years. But I think one sore point about what I do feel, my own perspective about this, though, is it's also about the actions we are now taking to fight this, which is this thing of national lockdown. which we haven't modeled. There's no scenario. We sort of seem to have copied what they're doing in Europe and just pasted it. We haven't quite, you know, it's not based on any well thought out model or analysis to say this will happen if we have moderate lockdown, partial lockdown, and full lockdown.
This is what you guys are saying. Look, schools are shut. You are going to have distorted calendars. Some businesses are going to fold up, whether you like it or not. Yeah. As we speak now, some people can't pay salaries. The oil price is nosediving. And so at the end of the people do not rise to think of how do we as a people, you know, begin to change the narrative. Because if you wait for this government, because while this is on, that was when the National Assembly member, the House of Rep particularly, took delivery of 20 million per car vehicles. So even if it's loan, you now begin to wonder. And yet these are people, this is a federal government that is expecting money from donors to combat the sit at home, to give palliative. And so it is not enough for people to sit down, fold their hands and say, oh, look, we'll probably be back to business as usual when all of this is over.
Yes.
There are a lot of things that are going to be happening. A lot of people will sell some of their property. Some will have to relocate, you know, from the cities to the villages. So all of this, if the government need to begin to imagine,
I think,
you know, all of this that will happen after the lockdown.
I think it was Albert Einstein that said one of his famous quotes, something about, you know, it's not, his greatest asset is not his ability to read books or understand books, or it is his imagination.
Okay. Yes.
And so what we see here clearly is a failure of imagination.
Yeah, that's true.
In terms of imagining what there's different scenarios and what impact will be and how we as a government, as a people, should manage this.
But let me go on.
For now, we seem to be very happy, you know, let's lock down. Share, we talked about it, 2.5 million. Let's assume they will give 20,000 naira to 2.5 million people. Now you add 1 million people more in a population of 200 million. Where you have your people, about 75% of your people live below, you know, $2 a day. And then you have about 65% of these same people who do not have access to clean water, you know. And yet, you're talking about giving palliative to 3.5 million persons. The palliatives that we're talking about can barely even stretch them for the 14 days that you're talking about. And then, say, companies are folded. Some of them are not producing. Some of them won't pay salaries. And so if they don't pay salaries, some of the people that you felt could afford, you're going to pull them down, you know, the poverty level further down. And then when you come, most of these funds you have spent, because of the price of oil, being a mono economy, because of the price of oil, to regain this fund will be a big problem for you. Some of these states are already battling to pay salaries. And so you're still going to have a situation where salaries are going to be owed. So without all, federal government is not imagining this.
Yeah.
So there's need for the people to sit down and say, we've got to where we are because the previous leaders and the current ones have failed us. And if we consistently fold our hands, heaven bless us, this is just one.
Yeah, I mean, what if another one happens? Taking it from what you said, I think sometimes the impression we give is that we want to reap where we didn't sow, even as a people. Are we saying that we're surprised that we're seeing what we're seeing? It's like a report card. If you don't study, why are you expecting to get an A? So you have a group of people who consistently have shown themselves not only to be lacking in competence, but not even the interest, the will to do the right thing. So now you come, you have something like COVID-19. Sorry, Chuka, you're in there. You have something like coronavirus, and it's like a report card period. And we're seeing it manifest that they don't have the capacity to think or to come up with genuine solutions. But when you have people like Ihekwazu who are competent, you're seeing that they also are shining, even though they're constrained by the apparatus around them. So you do have a few people who are showing some spark of genius, but they're only doing that because they already had it. You see what I mean? You can't give what you don't have. Chuka, you wanted to say something?
No, just saying, I was when you were talking, I realized that when you were talking about they don't have the capacity, and I said, yes, that's the imagination Emeka was talking about. They don't have any imagination, so they've copied and pasted, and nothing really. In the UK now, they say once the prime minister is back, or even before he comes back, They're going to ask him that, look, what's the exit strategy for the lockdown? In other words, they want to come out of lockdown.
Yes.
So when you
can you imagine that being strategy here? What is your exit strategy?
Yes.
Already.
But when you ask with, you know, for exit strategy here, they will, will take it from the political prism first. Oh, he's criticizing the president. Or he does not, you have not even thanked government for what they are doing. And here you are asking for, you know, we cannot, if this thing goes beyond what we already have, it's difficult to be difficult to manage.
I think this whole thing, in my view, is move the lockdown, so-called lockdown or whatever, move it from a lockdown to an information community participation kind of thing. You take this thing down to the various high-risk communities, you identify where those high-risk communities are, and you find a system of mitigating and managing them and providing this. So, for example, people who cook, let's take Agege, for example. There's a bakery there, so people are suffering. Get 2-3 bakeries to still operate and provide bread for people.
And
get water, if there are water pumps there, to provide water.
That's why for me,
you know, so you work it from a community perspective.
Yes, it has
give
to be.
Give them opportunities to be part of it.
That's why I had consistently insisted that this approach of using one medicine to cure all will not work.
All I can say is thanks, Chuka, for making time to drop in on us VIP style. I'll be taking things up after the break.